Gathering family, we want you to know that we miss you. I miss seeing your face. I'm in this room, and y'all aren't here. And I have been reminded this week that God is delivering us out of the desert, out of Egypt, just like he did the Israelites. Took them out of that place that was so hard and so painful, and he brought them into the promised land. And I have felt like that's what God wanted to say to us today. That he is moving us from the desert to the promised land. 2020 has been what it is, but it is not bigger than God. And so our invitation to you today is that you just enter into his presence in Jesus' name. I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh. Come on, church, sing it out. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea. You have led. But
I've torn apart the sea and led me through the deep. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
From the depths of a Roman prison cell, the Apostle Paul wrote one of his churches and said, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near." Friends, I have great news this morning that whether you are worshiping from your home, you're worshiping while on a walk around the neighborhood, or you're worshiping at Umstead Park, and with us on a Sunday morning, a Sunday night, a Wednesday midday, wherever you are, whenever you are worshiping with us, today we celebrate that the Lord is near. And when two or three are gathered in His name, the Lord said He would be with us. And so friends, we have been empowered by God's Spirit to rejoice. Whatever our circumstances, whatever our troubles, whatever our trials in this odd season of life, God has gifted us with God's presence that we might be a people who rejoice in the Lord always. My name is Reverend Will McLean, and I serve as pastor of The Gathering. And whether this is your first time watching or you are a regular worshiper, I want to welcome you and say no one belongs here more than you do. This morning, I believe God has a special message through the witness of Reverend Hill about how you might live a life of generosity and in so doing, live the life that is truly life. As we prepare to worship and to sing and rejoice in God's fierce and passionate love, I invite you into a moment of stillness that you might feel God's presence and in so doing, rejoice in the Lord always.
Every turn, I come face to face with you.
could I be lost when you have called me found? Chase me down, seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Chase me down, seek me out.
Talked about St. Paul earlier writing to one of his churches and saying, rejoice in the Lord always. And I share with you also the recommendation and the exhortation that Paul gave one of his young disciples and pastors, Timothy, when he was encouraging him to be bold in talking about money and the life of a church. He goes on to say this. He says, you should encourage your church folks to be generous so that they can lay up for themselves a treasure that they will not really realize in this life, but in the future, the treasure of God's kingdom and of the treasury of heaven. And he ends that encouragement in 1 Timothy 6 by saying this. He says, encourage your church to take hold of the life that is truly life. As your pastor, I say to you that it's not the most comfortable thing in the world to talk about money, but I would hope that you would hear that throughout these next few weeks when we talk about stewardship, this is an invitation into the life that is truly life. This is the life of not being consumed by our selfish desires or by the latest marketing trends or ads or whatever have you. This is an opportunity to grow in generosity for the sake of reflecting God's love. And so as we prepare to pray this morning, I invite you to take a posture of openness to God. You can put your feet on the floor, as we often say, lift up your chest, open up your hands, bow your heads, don't bow your heads, look outside, don't look outside, whatever have you, however you feel comfortable to get into a place of openness before God. And would you pray with me? Lord, I pray that today you would open up our lives to receive your invitation to be generous. Not only in our giving of money, but in our giving of time, and oh God, in the offering of our talents, especially in this season of life wherein it seems we are short on time and short on opportunities to truly serve. Would you open up our hearts and our minds and our hands and our feet to be sent where you call us to be sent, to imagine new opportunities where you call us to imagine, and to offer up our lives sacrificially to you and to neighbor when you call us into self-sacrifice. We ask, O God, that in and through the word preached and proclaimed today, and through the witness of the Holding family, we would be encouraged to take hold of the life that is truly life. A life of reflecting your extravagant love and generosity. All of this we ask as we pray the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give to us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, might you now be blessed by hearing a special witness from the Holding family.
We started attending Edenton Street back in the first part of 2019. We had been sort of church shopping, if you will, for lack of a better word, for a little bit. And I knew about Edenton Street from a number of friends who attend, but really became more deeply aware of sort of the culture of Edenton Street when I was working at Alliance Medical Ministry, which is one of the nonprofit agencies that's supported by the church. When I was at Alliance, I got to know this incredible missional community group. And at the time I didn't know what a missional community was. And I was just like really humbled and inspired by the work that they were doing and the commitment to the service piece of the group. While we have not officially joined Edenton Street yet, we were slated to join actually the first weekend that COVID hit and we were all sent home. We've been attending for about a year and a half and just really fell in love with just about everything about it. It really just has felt like home for our family.
It was just warm. It just feels right. My kids love it. It feels very different, I think, than past experiences, which were all positive. It's I think it's been just a wonderful thing for my family.
In my day job, I work in the nonprofit sector and in fundraising. So I know firsthand how critical it is for a nonprofit organization to know the money that's coming in the doors. And so, making a gift has been the least that we can do to make that continue, to support everything about the church, from the programming to the actual building itself, to the wonderful staff who support us in so many ways. There's so much, first of all, that we get as a family, that giving back financially is just a way to say thank you. We are honored to make a gift, and we ask and hope that you'll join us in making a pledge for this next 2021 year. I believe that you can make your pledge online at esumc.org, and you'll also be receiving your pledge card in the mail very soon. So we hope you'll join us.
Good morning. H.L. Mencken was a humorist, a satirist, a commentator on American life in the first half of the 20th century. He once said these words, "Contentment is having $10 a month more in salary than your brother-in-law." Contentment? More money than your brother-in-law? Keep that in mind as we read this parable of Jesus, who told this to his early followers, and now I share it with you. "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into the vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon, about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. He said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last. May God add God's blessings to our hearing and to our understanding of this which we believe is God's word for us, God's people. And let us pray. Almighty God, open now our ears that we might hear your voice and these very human words which I will speak. Bless those words. May they transform our lives into the likeness of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. I've never had anyone say to me that the parable of the laborers in the vineyard was their favorite parable. I think that must have something to do with the pay scale there in the vineyard. If I were to ask you to identify yourself with some character in the parable, I suspect that many, maybe even most of us, would identify with the laborer who was hired on first thing in the morning and who worked throughout the day through the scorching heat, and then comes some Johnny-come-lately about 5 in the afternoon, and, well, you know the story. They take the pay envelopes, pass them out, and everyone gets the same. I doubt that many of us identify ourselves as one of those who got there about 3 in the afternoon or 5 in the afternoon. I think that what we fail to see is the generosity of God through the generosity of that landowner. But maybe even more disturbing to us is the fact that we do see ourselves in that parable. And we not only see ourselves as the one who's worked since early in the morning, but we see ourselves as one of those who grumbled, one of those who envied the good fortune of those who did not become hired on until late in the day. I think there's a couple of things that help us in regards to understanding this parable. And first of all is to remind ourselves that those who came late in the day didn't come late because they were lazy. They weren't late to work because they didn't want to work or were not looking for work. It says that the landowner went to the marketplace and asked them, "So why are you standing idle?" And they say, "Because no one has hired me." And so they are, in a sense, victims themselves, victims of what we might term unemployment. And another point that needs to be made is about this daily wage. In some translations, it's named as a denarius, which was a very small amount of money. It would only have been enough money for one person to live one day. And so if you were a laborer, you would have had to work 7 days a week in order to eat 7 days a week. And certainly it would not have been enough to support a family. Eugene Peterson, in his paraphrase of the scripture called The Message, he translates it or paraphrases it as a dollar. So it was hardly a windfall for those who came late to have received just one denarius. And certainly who among us would begrudge someone enough of a wage that would be equal to what's needed for a single day? I think the point of this parable is that the generosity of the landowner is merely a reflection of the generosity of God. But the hard part of the parable is that the laborers who come from early morning reflect oftentimes who we are. We are persons who often envy those who are recipients of God's good fortune. Well, you see, this isn't the first time that we read anything about envy in the Bible. I don't know. Do the names Cain and Abel mean anything to you? What about Jacob and Esau? Or maybe one of my favorite stories is the story of Joseph with that beautiful coat of many colors, but he ends up in a hole where his brothers have left him and ends up being sold into slavery. Why? Well, because the brothers envied Joseph and envied Joseph's good fortune, envied the relationship that Joseph had with his father. Do you know anything about envy? Have you ever had someone come by and say, come on and take a spin with me in my new car? And you get in and you smell that new car smell. A little envy there, maybe? Or maybe it's about your work. Anybody at your job ever gotten a promotion and, there was a bit of envy on your part? Maybe you thought that you were going to get that job, deserved that job. Or maybe even better, was there some incompetent person at your work that gets that new job? A little bit of envy there? Well, I'm a United Methodist pastor, and we know a lot about envy. Matter of fact, we have almost a system by which we can envy our colleagues. For many, many years, I would receive in the mail a book, and it was a fairly thick book, and it was the minutes of the annual conference. And in the back of that book, they would have every church in Eastern North Carolina Methodism. And it would have the statistics, and it would tell you how many members that church had, and it would tell you how many average worship attenders there were, and how many were in Sunday school, and how much the parsonage was worth. And then it would have the pastor's salary. And then come June, when ministers were moved, you only had to go to that book to see just how much nicer the new parsonage was from the parsonage where you had been serving, and how much the salary increase was, and how big church you were going to serve. I actually remember 1987, I was leaving Edenton Street Church as your associate pastor at the time, and I was going down to New Bern, to Garber Church, to be their pastor. And I think some people saw me as that person who came at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. It was a great appointment. It was a great move, we would call it. And I was over at Duke Divinity School that fall following, having moved to New Bern. And we were there for a convocation. And I remember going into a lecture hall, and a good friend from college days came in. I was sitting by myself, and he, with a wry smile, looked at me, and he said, I still like you. I'll sit with you. And I knew what he was talking about. He was talking about that there had just been some talk, and maybe it had been envy about the move. And I suspect, had I not been the recipient of that, I would have been envious as well. I know a good bit about envy. I know what it is to envy colleagues and envy what friends and acquaintances have. Matter of fact, I know all too often that I have rolled my eyes, maybe, when I've seen a colleague get a better appointment. And those rolling of eyes have simply been an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual envy. This parable is troublesome to us because it points out a bit about who we are and how it is that we find it difficult to find joy in the good fortune of others. And yet, Sunday after Sunday, we pray a prayer, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when we pray that prayer, we're praying for the fullness of God's kingdom to be lived out on earth. And what would that look like? Well, I think what it would look like would be for you and for me to be able to come home one afternoon after a colleague has been given a bonus and be able to say to our spouse or our friend or our child, good news, I've got good news. And they say, oh, did you get a bonus? And you say, no, I didn't, but Joe did, Sally did, and isn't that great news? In the kingdom of God, we are able to celebrate God's goodness. And not simply God's goodness as a recipient, but we are able to celebrate the graciousness of God in another's life. We're able to celebrate with those who are recipients of God's good fortune. We don't like this parable because we want something that looks fair. We say to ourselves, we want a fair God. But thank God, God is not simply fair, but God is generous. For inevitably in our lives, there are times when we are the person who shows up late for work. Time and again, we become the recipients of God's goodness and of God's grace. And so when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, I believe we are praying that God will give us eyes to see. Eyes to see the goodness of God. The eyes to see the many ways in which our lives have been graciously and generously blessed by God. I believe that when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, we are praying that we can become the people that God has intended us to be, that we can become the people who find joy in the good fortune of others. I'll tell you this now, and I'll tell you again. I have never found any joy in envy. I have never found any pleasure in being envious of anyone or of anything. When we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, we are praying for the day in our own life when we will not only celebrate God's generosity, but that we will have embraced that same generosity and been generous with our lives and generous in what we have. H.L. Mencken was not correct. Contentment is not making $10 a month more than your brother-in-law. Contentment is not found in envy. Contentment, fullness of life, the joy of living is found when we can celebrate the good fortune of others and be generous with all that we have. And let us pray. Almighty God, we pray that in our lives you will come and open our eyes to see the many ways that you have blessed and been generous to us, that you will show us how that we might be people that give celebration and joy to those who have been recipients of your good fortune. And, O God, save us from our envy and make us generous. Make us generous in all that we have and generous in all that we are. For we pray it in the name and in the power of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Your mercy never fails me. All of my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. have led me through the fire, the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good.
From this place to live not in envy, but to see the fullness of God's goodness in our lives. Let us go forth not to envy, but to be generous in all that we have and in all that we are. Go in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.